verse 8 in the NIV version of the Bible, and then I'm going to read Psalm 16, verse 11 out of the easy to read version, as well as the contemporary English version. James chapter 4, verse 8, when you have it, say amen. Somebody to intercede. It says, come near to God. Come near to God, and He will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Psalm 16 and 11 in the easy to read version says, you will teach me the right way to live. Just being with you bring complete happiness. Being at your right side will make me happy forever. Psalm 16, verse 11 in the contemporary English version, it says, you have shown me the path to life, and you make me glad. By being near to me, sitting at your right side, I will always be joyful. The grass may wither, the flower may fade, but the word of the Lord shall stand forever. You may be seated in the presence of our God. We have been talking about occupying and managing our moment. In the parable in Luke, Jesus tells the parable, and he says he gave certain gifts to servants, and he told them to occupy or manage until I come. He says, you'll know when your shift is over when I show up. But until I show up, you gotta work it. Until I show up, you gotta do what I have called you to do. And while every season is necessary, this season, the one that we are in right now, which we call spring, is very vital, because what's done in this season can determine how much manifestation we have in harvest. This is the season where we plant. This is the season where we actually begin to plant and allow nature and God to bring forth the manifestation. If the wrong decisions are made in spring, then consequences could be harsh during harvest time. Which means that if I don't plant the right stuff, and if I don't monitor what I'm doing now, then I shouldn't be shocked when there's no harvest during harvest time. And I don't know about you, but I need manifestation in my life. Amen. Amen. And so if the wrong decisions are made now, just like in the physical, the same is in the spiritual. This is the season of growth. And the only question is, what will we allow to grow? I want you to understand this. Few people understand that anything can grow in fertile ground. What you want to grow, and what you don't want to grow. I'm amazed at how people can say, how can a ministry be so anointed and have so many spiritual gifts and then have some messy stuff at the same time? Well, fertile ground will produce whatever is planted in it. And when you fertile, you can produce corn and you can produce marijuana, because the ground is not prejudiced. The ground is going to produce, if it's fertile, it's fertile, it's going to produce whatever. So this is a season in which we as spiritual people must understand that we have to plant and pluck at the same time. I got to plant what I know God wants in my life, but I also have to pluck out some stuff that I know that is not pleasing to God at the same time. How many people know that you're planting and you're plucking all at the same time? I'm learning more about God, and then He's showing me, you got to get rid of this. I'm tired of talking to you about this. You got to get rid of this. So I want to talk. which I took to the Lord. And I didn't realize it was an addiction until it began to deplete my peace and steal my joy and put me in a constant cycle of disappointment. I am totally certain, I'm not totally certain when it entered into my life, but by the time I became aware of it, it had set up camp in my life. It's funny when you say addictions, even the babies don't cry. The addiction that I had, and I still struggle with from time to time, the addiction was being consumed with the American dream. I was trying to serve God with this American dream and his kingdom at the same time. And I didn't realize I couldn't have dual citizenship. I became, and I'm a little emotional about it, because I don't like telling my business. I became addicted to the idea that there would be a day in which everyone in my life would act right. I became addicted to thinking that there would be a time where I would get myself together and all of the demons of my past would be buried. I had no idea that some of the stuff I fought in my 20s, I was still fighting in my 40s. And I got a feeling if I live to be 60, I'm going to be swinging my candidate. I thought that there would be a day when I would be free from all trouble, both mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, so that I would be free just to help other folks out. I sowed seeds into the church, thinking that if I give a good enough offering, that the devil would leave me alone eventually. I had a dream that once you pass certain tests in life, you could graduate and be free from the school of hard knocks. I was addicted to the American dream. Now listen, I'm telling you, I use scriptures and I bend the scriptures. I bent the scriptures and I manipulated the scriptures to help me feed my expectation of a carefree life here on this earth. After all, the psalmist did say, I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. But good isn't good if bad isn't present. Which means he was saying, no matter what's going on in my life, I'm going to see the good, but I realize that bad will always be here. I hope you're getting me. Look, I quoted that he would feed me in the presence of my enemies. I quoted that, and then I prayed and asked him to get rid of all my enemies. I prayed and I quoted that he will lead me through the valley of the shadow of death. That's a low place, but I never expected to be in a low place. I always said I was above and never beneath. I quoted that he would do all of these wonderful things, and my addiction, listen, my addiction altered and contaminated my prayer life. And slowly but surely, my requests became bigger than my relationship with God. Slowly but surely, I stopped talking about him and I started talking about my stuff 24/7. If you've ever been addicted to the American dream, You've read the scriptures, but you decided to delete the part that you didn't want. Come on. I know the song, I love the song. You can have whatever you like. That's a lie. It's a nice pink nightwear and everything else, but you cannot have whatever. Come on. No, you can't. I'm trying to bust you up right now. I need to let you know that serving God don't mean you're not going to be disappointed. I thought I could get five folks in here that can testify. Here it is. If you've ever been addicted to the American dream, your joy, your contentment, your peace is always right behind this four-letter word, win. I'll be happy when I get married. I'll be happy when I get a divorce. I'll be happy when I get the job. I'll be happy when the kids grow up. I'll be happy when I pay the bill off. I'll be happy when I get the house. I'll be happy when I pay the house off. I'll be happy when I get the car. I'll be happy when I get the better diagnosis. I don't know about you, but I am tired of waiting on when to happen. Always win. It implies that the right person, listen to me, church, it implies that the right person is going to bring contentment. That's a hard charge. I don't care how fine she is or how nice he looks, he will never bring contentment because there is an itch in your soul that only God can scratch. Y'all better say something. I cannot be Latina Conway's everything. Those shoes are way too big for flesh. And she set herself up for disappointment every time. So, the right job is going to settle the matter. The right church is going to settle the matter. The right boo is going to settle the matter. The right city is going to settle the matter. And it's always win. Healing will take away. When I'm healed, Lord, allow me to be healed. But even once you heal, it won't take away the threat of it coming back. I know what I'm talking about. My mother-in-law was healed. But even after she was healed, she had to fight mentally and spiritually of the threat God was saying unto me of it coming back. So I'm just talking to y'all today because I know what I'm about to do. So like any other addicted person who had come to the end of the ropes, I prayed and said, this wasn't long ago. God, please settle the matters of my heart. I said, settle the matters of my heart. And God said, the matters of your heart, Jawan, will never be settled until you settle in me. Somewhere to lay my head on this earth. And he said, I didn't leave you a pillow, I left you me. I want you to get this. He said, I want you to settle in my presence. I want you to settle in my word. My word has already been established. He says, Juan, you have no chance of being settled until you realize that I came to give you something that this world could never offer. I came to give you me. Oh my God. I want you to kind of horse, I'll tell you, but I want you to really hear. God said, I came to give you me. Thank you. something with you. It's always something with you. You can walk through a house that you didn't even deserve and complain all day. It's always something with you. You can have a refrigerator full of food and complain about who won't cook it, because it's always something with you. Oh, my God. You got a closet full of clothes but don't feel like ironing nothing. And then it's always something with you.
Come on, praise him. Come on, praise him. Come on, praise him.
on, praise him. Come on, praise him. Come on, praise him. And you got the words. Come on, tell me, I'm going to get on your words. Somebody wish they still had their mama. You got the words. Say, kids, get on your words. Somebody wish they still had their kids. I will bless the Lord.
Thought that was for everybody else.
So I said, Lord, I pray agenda, my way of doing things, to saturate this space. But I never told you to think that this would be a subdivision of heaven. I don't know where I got this stuff. I swear, I don't know. I think I was watching too much TV. Look here, the Huxtables, they never had no real problems. I mean, no real real stuff like we had. The Brady Bunch, I mean, really, a woman and three kids, and a man and three kids, and everybody got saved, and everybody fine. No baby mama drama. No, no, you ain't my daddy. You ain't my mama. Come on, TV will get you drunk. And then you look at your stuff and say, what is wrong with us? We all messed up. No, no, they just lying. You live in reality. He says, what you need is to make it your mission to get in my presence and stay there. And don't come out. Did you hear what I said, man? He says, let me tell you, you have been looking for all kinds of things to fulfill you. And it don't last. What you need to do is get in my presence and stay there. Because only I can fulfill. Y'all don't understand. He says, I'm trying to wean you off your addiction, Conway. Because when you have these images, everybody acts right. And all your kids married the right person. And all your grandkids went to college. And nobody went to jail. Everybody eat what was right. And even you can eat whatever you want to eat, and you can still be a ripped stomach and be 200 pounds. And you gotta, I'm trying to get you out of your little reality and your little image that everything is gonna work out the way you want it to work out. That mama gonna live till she 100, and daddy gonna live till he 100, and they all gonna be healthy, and they ain't gonna have heart disease, and they ain't gonna have diabetes, and they ain't gonna have cancer. I'm trying to get you to come out, because as long as you stay addicted to your image, you will always be offended with me. Because I didn't do what you told me to do. Look at somebody say, it may not turn out the way I want it to, but I'm staying. Oh, how I stand. Because I don't worship him for what I understand. I worship him by faith. Though I worship him by faith, and I'm saved. I know in whom I have believed. And I believe that he will be with me no matter what's going on in my life. And I'm saved. I need somebody to holler out of his soul. I'm staying. So, let me get this. There are some byproducts that come from being in the presence of God. There are some things that's on you that must fall off when you stay in the presence of God. Somebody scream, people can't do it. Come on, come on, come on, holler. People can't do it. Come on, come on. Stop getting them off the hook. when you dwell in his presence. You don't have to be a biblical scholar to get this. You just got to have a made up mind that I'm going to stay in his presence. Say this after me. My expectation is of the Lord. Say it again. My expectation is of the Lord. So I'm releasing everybody else. I'm releasing everybody else because my answer, I'm through expecting flesh to do it. I'm through expecting flesh to do it. If flesh do it, it'll be a side salad. It won't be the entree. Come on, because my expectation is of the Lord. So I give you this. I give it up. Elisha. In Kings, Elisha is with his assistant, and they are surrounded by enemies. And the assistant is a believer, just like Elisha is. They are in the same spot, but they ain't in the same place. So the assistant is saying, look at all of these people that's got us surrounded. And Elisha is calm, cool, and collected because they're in the same spot, but they ain't in the same place. Elisha has spiritually seen that God has encamped an army of angels all around him. You can be on the same pew, but not be in the same place. Come on, talk to me. It means that Elisha prayed and said, Lord, open up his eyes so he can see what I see. Because he's seeing what's against us. I'm seeing what's for us. I need you to holler, God is for me. God is for me and mine. Come on, bless her. God is for me. That's him being in this place. The second example, and I got one more, is there is a mother found in Matthew chapter 15 who runs to the presence of Jesus. She runs to the presence of Jesus, and his disciples are giving her attitude because she don't belong to their church. So instead of being disciples, they are lousers. But the woman had to move beyond their attitude, because when you're desperate, you ain't got time to be a human. Y'all better say something up in here. When you're desperate, you just ain't got time to be a human. Offense is for the luxury of those folks that got options. But when you ain't got no option, you ain't got time to be a human. Roll your eyes if you want to. I'm coming up in this camp, but I got to get down and get on the road. Y'all better say something up in here. I don't care who don't like me, who don't speak to me, who don't prefer not being here. I'm looking for something, and I'm going to get what I got to get. She goes to Jesus, and she tries to get in his presence, and the disciples say, send her away from us, and not realizing that she didn't come for them. She came for Jesus. And she went to Jesus and she said, heal my daughter who's vexed with a demon. And Jesus told the woman, no. He says, no. I got to do it for the Jews before I do it to the Gentiles. And she worshiped disappointed. She didn't walk away with a twisted leg and neck saying, I'm done with you. I'm done with church. I can go somewhere else. I got to put it up. No, she didn't have no other options. So even though he told her no, she still said, you're God. And even if y'all not saying it, you still have to worship God even when he told you no. See, we got a new generation that if God tells them no, they change gods. We got a new generation that if I don't get it from Jesus, I'll get it from Mohammed. I'll get it from the kingdom. I'll get it from somewhere else. But I need some bona fide Christian that says that even though he tells me no, that don't change his position of being my God. God, come out of here. changed his verdict. Because she could handle or no. Do I have any parents in here that told your child no, but they had a good attitude about the no? So it made you more room and say, well, if I just pay the next bill next week instead of this week, and if I give half on the water bill instead of this week. Why are you trying to make accommodations? Because he could handle a no. It's something, oh, I'm not saying that. When God can see that you will bless him even when you didn't make it with your spouse, or when you didn't get that job, or when you didn't get that house. I need some disappointed disciples to begin to bless him right now. He might change it for you if you start blessing him. He might turn it around for you if you start blessing him. Tell you, if you give your hand to Jesus, everything is going to be alright. I need you to keep on scrolling, because we will tell the truth up in here. We will tell the truth up in here. He's able to deliver me out of fire, but even if he don't,
I take what I do. If you turn your
walk past you, and I'm going to let the glory on my glory go fall on the rock. And if you see a rock, you'll see me. You didn't catch that. He says, I know you can't see me and live, but if you see the rock, I'll put the glory on the rock. This rock is Jesus. He's the one. The Bible says that Moses stared at the rock and God went past him and he was able to see the backside of God. Now I want you to get this. He couldn't see where he was going, but he could see where he had been. I'm going to give you 3 seconds to look back over your life and acknowledge where God has been.
This one is dry. It's clean, but it's dry.
This one is clean, but it has been in the oil. The oil represents the presence of God. The oil is where you get the word of God. The oil is where you have a relationship and you ain't just asking for stuff. You asking for Him. The oil of God prepares you for the presence of God. This spoon is saturated in oil. So when it gets into the real presence of God, it comes out wearing. This is powdered sugar. The powdered sugar is really not connected to the spoon. The powdered sugar is connected to the oil. I need y'all to get this right here. God says, when you get oily, you're going to wear me every day, all day, in every place. Somebody get those hands and say, Lord, anoint me with fresh oil. Fresh oil.
You're not, I'm not, I'm not, I'm
want y'all scared. You're not going to make it. I hear Holy Spirit say, until you detach your joy from what you want, it ain't gonna happen. You need them to like you too much. You need them to value you too much. Until you detach it, I'm a jealous God. And I'll have no other. Come on. As good as I have been to you, you still sit there complaining about who won't give you a like on social media, something is wrong with your head.
Zechariah 13:9 declares, "This third I will put into the fire. I will refine them like silver and test them like gold. They will call on my name and I will answer them. I will say, they are my people. And they will say, the Lord is our God." The refinery is a place where we watch God take raw materials and we apply the fire of His word to remove all impurities and use His Holy Spirit to reform us into tools fit for His glory. We are a Christian organization whose mission is to help individuals transform, develop, and mature by equipping them with tools to live an impactful and successful life.